Not only do vocabularies expand over time with new words being added, but the words themselves change over time. It's difficult to realize sometimes that some words have been around for millennia. The same word essentially has been part of the vocabulary of a language for longer than its recorded history. Other words have changed, and we get used to having words being stable, but nevertheless they do change. Some people object to vocabulary items changing, and they write letters to the editor of newspapers complaining that particular words no longer mean what they did, or something about them has changed. They're no longer being pronounced the way they did when the person writing was young, and so forth. Linguists are interested in change, but they tend not to try and make judgments about whether that's good or bad. It just happens. This change over time is partly a result of the fact that the moment that a word comes into a vocabulary, it tends to take on some idiosyncrasy, some peculiarity. And the reason is that when a word has been coined and is then adopted into a speech community as a fully paid-up member of the vocabulary, it's usually done because it's doing something useful, and so the idiosyncrasy comes as part of the package. That's particularly obvious with the case of compound nouns, as we saw earlier. Most compound nouns have some kind of idiosyncrasy. Look, for example, at the case of skydiving. Once upon a time, people started jumping out of aeroplanes, and they thought of this as skydiving. There's obviously an element of diving about it. It's a kind of diving, and it's obviously done in the sky. But there's a great deal more to it than that. If you merely dive about in the sky, that isn't skydiving. Skydiving is a recreational activity. Parachute jumping, if you're in a parachute regiment in the military, isn't skydiving. Skydiving you do for fun, at least that's the theory. Not only that, you don't just dive in the sky, you actually dive out of an aeroplane, and the aeroplane is in the sky with you inside it when you do the diving. That's not something that's obvious when you learn the word skydiving. Secondly, you don't just dive out of the aeroplane. Part of skydiving is to have a parachute on, and another part of skydiving is to open the parachute at some point before you hit the ground. All of that is something we know. We know that skydiving is a recreational activity involving parachuting to the ground and a certain amount of free fall, and so forth. That's idiosyncratic knowledge that isn't part of the language, but it is part of knowing that vocabulary item. Another thing that happens, not just at the moment when something is lexicalized, is that over time, words can change their meaning. Not all words change their meaning. Common or garden vocabulary items relating to parts of the body, for example, haven't changed their meaning much over the recorded history of the word. The word head and the word foot and so on, they've been around for a long time, and obviously they haven't had to change because they're doing the job perfectly well. Sometimes words change their denotation. That is, they used to denote one kind of set and they now denote another kind of set. Sometimes the set is a bigger one than it was before. Look, for example, at the case of the word barn. We know that a barn is a large shed on a farm used for storing things. Well, the B-A-R at the beginning gives you a bit of a clue that once upon a time that may not have been so. In fact, it was a shed for storing barley. Well, now it's a shed for storing everything, so the denotation has widened. The opposite, of course, is semantic narrowing. Sometimes words narrow their meaning. Have a look at disease. If you look compositionally at that, the ease bit means ease and dis means not. So a disease was something that made you not at ease. Well, that's not what it means now. What it means now is some kind of medical reason why you're not at ease. You can also change the semantics by changing the connotation, the emotional aura, if you like, around the word. Sometimes the word was okay, but it gets worse. That's called pejoration, as in pejorative, having bad connotations. Here's a word that isn't very positive in its connotations. The word lewd means rude, usually sexually rude in some way, lewd jokes and lewd behavior. It's a rather legal word. It's used in legal statutes. Well, it has an interesting history. In the Middle Ages, the population of Christian Europe was divided into those who had had an education, those who were learned, who were called the lærd, and then there were those who hadn't had an education, the layward. Well, the lærd were all clerics. They were all priests and monks and the like. Nuns were all lærd, and the rest of the population was the lay population, the non-clerical population. Well, the lay population were the layward, the non-clerics. Well, the clerics were supposed to be chaste. Poverty, chastity, and obedience was what they were up to, whereas the non-clerics, they could be involved in all sorts of other activities that the clerics weren't. Well, the clerics didn't maybe think well of that, and so lewd gradually came to have bad connotations, whereas previously it had just been the lay people. Sometimes the opposite happens, and words that had a poor connotation end up with a better one. They are ameliorated. The word knight is an interesting example in English. If we go back far enough, the word knight meant a male servant, and it still does in German. And in German, you can still hear the K. In German, the word is Knecht, a male servant. Well, that doesn't have terribly good connotations. In the middle of the Middle Ages, knights became rather more important because their lords became important, and knights came to be chaps with armor and handsome and castles and so forth, and that rather improved things. So in the late Middle Ages, knights of the realm were considered rather splendid. So their position improved, and the connotations of the word knight also improved. Another way in which meanings change is that a word which was used literally comes to be used metaphorically and gains an additional meaning, that is, it becomes polysemous. Let's have a look at the word blind alley. Well, an alley doesn't have any eyes, so it can't see, but we have the word blind being used here to mean not unable to see, but without any prospect at the end. So a blind alley is one that leads nowhere. You can't see out of it, if you like. So the word blind here is used metaphorically, and a very large amount of polysemy is a result of metaphorical transfer. So the meaning of the word blind has changed because another related meaning has been added to it. And we saw that earlier with all those ring cases, and you can doubtless think of many others. Well, not only does the meaning of words change in time, but words change their form. Very obviously, when the sound pattern of a language changes, as it has in English, for example, the word knight used to be Knecht, the K disappeared and the Ch, that sound no longer exists in modern English. So any sound change in general changes the form of a word in particular. But there are other changes of form that are more peculiar, idiosyncratic, related to individual words. For example, we can decide, as we do sometimes, that a word is rather longer than we fancy, and we just clip a piece off it. If we look at these words, the word flu was once upon a time influenza, and in some publications it still is, but influenza is a pretty long word, so one syllable will do instead. The word bus used to be omnibus. An omnibus is a Latin word meaning for everybody. So carriages used to just be for people who could own carriages, whereas omnibuses were for everybody, not just people who could afford a carriage. And Fred, of course, is short for Frederick. And many of you will have given names that have been clipped. Sometimes you might like that, and sometimes perhaps you don't. Sometimes people, when they get a little older, decide, I want to go back to my full name, thanks very much. Sometimes the internal structure of a word, and we've seen how words can be morphologically complex, that can shift over time, and the internal structure of the word can be erased, if you like. It can disappear so that we no longer see the word as having internal structure. And here's a nice example. This word was originally used in the north of England, and if you look at the first four letters, the meaning of that is wind. Well, what about the second two letters? Well, originally they were from Norse, from the Viking languages that arrived in the north of England with the Vikings, and the word was augr, which is the Norse word for eye. So originally window was wind eye. Why wind eye? Well, most houses couldn't afford glass. Glass was terribly expensive, but you did want to see out of them, so you basically banged a hole in the side. Well, if you bang a hole in the side of a house, the wind gets in. So, wind eye, the eye for the wind. Well, the structure of that is that nobody recognizes this as a compound anymore, and its structural properties have disappeared. It's now only one simple free morpheme. As we've seen, changes take place in grammatical categories through conversion, but there are more specific changes that sometimes take place. Remember that there are proper nouns, the real names of real people and places with capital letters on them. Well, sometimes these proper nouns come to be common nouns when they're used for something associated with the person. The diesel engine is named after a chap whose name was Diesel. The bowler hat, the bowler, was named after a hatter, Mr. Bowler. And so now we have a bowler with a small b, when originally it was associated with Mr. Bowler with a capital B. And by the way, just as an aside, you know why there are mad hatters? Hatters cured pelts with poisonous substances, mercury in particular. And so when you use mercury for long enough, it vaporizes when it's warm, and you end up with mercury poisoning, and that makes you go slightly bonkers. So, unfortunately, Mr. Bowler, who made the bowler hats, usually out of beaver pelts, may in fact have been slightly mad. Well, we've now talked about adding to the vocabulary in the variety of ways that we can. We've talked about changes that take place in the vocabulary, but it also happens that words disappear from the vocabulary. If that happens in a language which is not written down, and the last person forgets a particular word, then the word is gone for all time. However, in the case of written languages, the word sort of sticks around in old versions of the writing. There are lots of words that we can still regard as parts of English because they are written in books, although nobody would use them anymore. And here's an example, and it's not that long since that these words were used. Of the various types of carriages now in vogue, and remember we have to find out when now is, the Victoria, in its many varieties of form, is the most popular, accompanied as of necessity by the double Victoria, sociable, brougham, landaulet, and landau. Well, all of these were obviously the proper names of varieties of carriage. Most of you haven't a clue what a Victoria is. A sociable sounds rather nice. A landaulet is probably a little landau, and a landau must be a big landaulet. Well, I don't know what any of these are except the landau, because the landau sometimes comes out when the royal family in Britain have a special occasion. It's an open carriage that looks rather like a pram. It has very large wheels, and people sit in this large pram facing each other. There are two seats on opposite sides. And sometimes, going down the Mall, you can see the royals sitting in this large pram, waving to each other, and it's, instead of having just one canopy, it has two in case it rains. Apart from that, I've no idea what any of these are. To all intents and purposes, the words have disappeared from English, except for the people who love carriages, and I'm sure that there are people who are well up on carriages. I'm not one of them. Well, this is taken from the 10th edition of the Encyclopaedia Britannica, which was published around the turn of the 19th and 20th centuries. So, in 100 years, these words have pretty much disappeared. So what we've basically been able to show is that words have histories. They have a life of their own. It's important to think that words are things we might respect because they're older than us, most of them. They've been around for ages. They have a life of their own. They don't ask to be uttered. They don't ask to be in dictionaries. They're very peaceable on their own, but they have a history. And some of them have a much longer history even than the English-speaking peoples. They've been around for thousands of years. Maybe some of them were uttered by the first people who ever spoke 150, 200,000 years ago. Obviously, they've changed. They're not the same as they were. Their history is called their etymology. Every word that exists, every lexical item has a history. Maybe it was only made up yesterday. Maybe it was made up 5,000 years ago by someone. Speakers don't know what this history is. We haven't a clue about the history of words. We have to look it up. It's not the case that in your dictionary every word has a little chronological label on it saying invented 5,000 BC. We just don't know what that history is. But in some cases we can look it up. There's a dictionary, and we'll have a look at the etymology in dictionaries in a little while.